So what we need to remember, grade 12s, is you're actually very lucky. A few years ago, the formats of the papers changed, and now you know what to expect in paper one and what to expect in paper two. So we need to remember that when we are going to be engaging in this session today, it's so important for us to remember the rules. And I hope that these rules are rules that you can easily abide by. So the first rule of today is going to be to try all the questions. Grade 12s, it's so important for us to make sure that we try each and every single question, because even if a question counts 10 marks or 12 marks, you will get marks for parts of the question that you have attempted. Ask your teacher in your classroom if you are unsure about anything. So if there's anything in the session, any question, maybe some answers that don't make sense to you, ask your teacher if you are unsure, and then the teachers can post in the chat if they want us to go over something, or if we're going too fast, or if we're going too slow. Always make a star next to questions you want to go back to. So there might be some questions today that you think, sure, I need some more help with how to approach these questions. So make sure that you make a star next to those questions, and don't be afraid to share your answers. There's going to be times where I'm going to give you time to do your calculations, and then your teachers can either post your answers in the chats, or they can even send me a WhatsApp with a picture of your answers so that I can see how you got to the answer. So those are the rules of the day. I really hope that those will be manageable, and that those will also show you that it's so important for us to always try and try and try. So, grade 12s, if we start looking at paper one, so now we're going into full-on paper one mode. What can we expect in paper one? So first of all, you should know from your prelims that you wrote recently that paper one and paper two will both have a duration of 3 hours. So it means you will have 3 hours to complete the paper, and the paper will be a total of 150 marks. Now, it's always nice to give yourself an idea of what to expect when you are preparing for this paper. So, if we look at how paper one is going to be set out, you will see that paper one will be plus minus 60% finance. So, you can see quite a lot of finance. And then plus minus 35% data handling, and then plus minus 5% probability. So, that means there can be a 5% play between and data, but you know that the majority of this paper will consist of finance questions. Then it's also nice to know not just what the percentage allocation will be to the topics, but also for you to know what you can expect. So if we look at question one, we can expect finance, we can expect data handling and probability. But what is so important for us to note is that question one will only be level one questions. So it will be around 30 marks, so about 20% of the paper. But the nice thing is, when we know it's all level one questions, we know those are the questions we should score the marks on. Then question two will be on finance and perhaps a little bit of probability, and that will cover all four levels of questions. Question three will be about data handling and perhaps some probability, again covering all four levels, and then question four and or five. So your question paper can either consist of four questions or of five questions, and then that will be integrated questions. So it means there will be some parts that will be a little bit of finance, little bit of data, and a little bit of probability. So what you can see is question one is the only one that will only be level one. So this is definitely a good place for us to start when we start answering our questions. Now, some tips to get you started. You can read through that quickly, and then I will just maybe highlight one or two for you. So the first thing is, we really need to make sure that we check the mark allocation. So in other words, if a question counts 2 marks, we're not going to spend 10 minutes on the question. It shouldn't take us 10 minutes if it only counts 2 marks. So make sure that we use the mark allocation to guide us in the time we spend per question. And then we need to make sure we answer in the right unit, that we look out for rounding instructions. That is so important. And we will practice those skills today in our session that we are busy with. So if we look at the topic of finance, so what you'll see is I've got this topic for you on the PowerPoint. It's also in your learner notes. So it gives you all the different sections that can be tested. So you'll see we can do financial documents, tariffs, income expenditure, profit loss, income and expenditure statements, budgets, cost price, selling price, break-even analysis, interest, and so on. I'm not going to read through all of that. Those are all of the sections that can be tested. So what I said in there is we can use this as a checklist. First of all, we can even go through it today and see when we do the activities, which of these sections have we touched on? And you can say, if we, for instance, do a question on tariff systems today, but you didn't get all the right answers while you were working through it, you can even make a little star next to it to remind yourself this is a section that I maybe still need help with. Just a reminder, we only have 3 hours for our session today. So it means we're not going to be able to go through all of these sections, but you can even read through this. And from here, you might know which of these sections that we're not going to touch on today do you still need help with. So if you know there was a question on exchange rates in your prelim, for instance, and it wasn't an easy question for you, you can also indicate that so that when you go back to school next term, you can ask your teacher to help you with questions specifically on that unit. Now, the first skill we are going to focus on today is how to extract information from financial documents. So you can see financial documents is a section, but now we're going to look at a skill. How do we get information from financial documents? And you will see what I've got on the screen for now is I've just got the information on the screen. I haven't even looked at the questions yet. So what we need to remember, grade 12s, is that we always need to look at information. Right, this is an invoice. So that means this is one of the types of financial documents you must know, and you need to know what does it mean? What does an invoice actually show you? Then we can see there's some information, there's some more information, a little bit more information. Then it gives us material description, and you'll see there are units in some of them. You'll see there's a quantity, which we know is an amount. You'll see the prices given are in rands, but it says there excluding VAT. So just a reminder, now it already means that VAT is something that we're going to bring into this specific concept. And then you'll see this is the cost in rand. Then it gives you a subtotal, a VAT amount, and the amount payable. So now we've already just looked at this to find out some information. So it means that the prices that they give us here are excluding VAT. So in other words, when we add VAT, we're going to actually pay more than this. And something else that we can see is if we look here, there's a letter A. So normally we know when there's a letter in place of a number, it means that is going to be a missing value that we are going to have to find. So we always spend some time before we look at the questions. And that's why you get that reading time also at the beginning of the exam. You spend some time, you give yourself some time to get to know the document that you are going to be working with before you start answering the questions. So if we look at the question says, Petra Shabangu bought material from a local hardware store. Annexure A shows the invoice of the purchase. So this will be in Annexure A. So that means we're going to have our question paper open, and right next to it, we are going to have our Annexure open. Right. So the first question, nice and easy. Write down. So when it says write down, that's an instruction. So it's telling us we are not going to do a calculation. We are going to look for the stand number. So now I go back to the document. I look for the stand number and I see the stand number is 859. Sorry. C. I made a mistake there already. Write down the stand number because I didn't finish the question. The stand number of the purchaser. So there I needed to finish the question. If I look at purchaser, that means it is this person here. This stand number over here is the stand number of the place providing the goods to us. And this is the stand number of the purchaser. So it shows us how important it is to just finish reading the question. So there we go. 2 marks, nice and easy. But it's also showing you how easy it is to lose 2 marks if you didn't read the question completely. If we look at the next question, calculate the value of A. So now the words that they gave us is calculate. So now it means I'm going to have to multiply, divide, add, or subtract. Calculate the value of A. So now I'm going to go back. I'm going to use my highlighter again. And I'm going to say, oh, remember, this is A. And they're asking the number of bags of PPC cement that they bought. So now I can see, do I know what unit price means? Unit price means the price for one. So if the price for one is 96 rand 95, and I paid in total 1,939 rand, how many bags did I buy? So I will take the total amount that I paid divided by the price for one bag, giving me 20 bags. So one method accuracy for knowing I must divide the total by the price for one, and then an accuracy for getting to the number of cement bags. So the word was calculate, and they asked us the number of bags. So we knew we had to go back to the table, go back to the PPC cement, which was the first thing we did, and then do the question from there. If we look at the third question, list. So when the word is list, so now we can see our keyword here that they give us is list. List 2 ways in which the company can be reached. So if you want to phone them to ask them something or make sure if they have stock of something, we can quickly have a look at ways we can reach them. We can either phone them or we can send them an email. So you can phone them or you can send them an email. So those are the 2 ways that you can reach the company. Nice, because it says 2 ways, you are going to get 1 mark for each way that you have mentioned. If we look at the next question, this is a lovely level 1 question that we get asked quite often, to write a definition. Now, what is very, very, very important for us to do here is we need to make sure that we define the term within the context. So grade 12s, it means even if you have practiced what is an invoice and you know from the top of your head how to define it, it is important for you to still now have a look at how you are going to define this in the context. So if we look at this, we know an invoice is a document that the buyer, in this case the school, received when they purchased something, indicating all the details of the purchase. So that is what we are going to say the definition is. Otherwise, what you can do is you can also say that the definition would be a document showing Njubane Secondary School all the cost of the items they bought. That's also fine. You don't have to give the textbook definition. As long as you are explaining clearly to me who is getting the invoice and what they are getting from this invoice. Right. Now, 2 marks, nice and easy. And you know that it's actually not that difficult because when they ask you to define something, grade 12s, there will be clues in the context. You can see in the annexure, there's clues as to how the definition should look. Now, the next question says, show how. Right. If show how is the word that we are going to use here, we need to remember when they ask you to show how they got to this subtotal of 6,364 rands and 10 cents. So go back to the annexure. Subtotal 6,364,10. They are asking you show how it was calculated. So when they ask you to show how, it means they are not asking you if it is correct. They're not asking you to tell them if it is now correct. They are telling you, right, this is what you must get as an answer. Show me how you get to that answer. So if we look at this, we can see subtotal in this case is the total of all of the quantities, all of the materials I bought before the VAT was added in this case. So you'll see the subtotal plus the VAT will actually give you the amount payable. So we now know we will take the subtotal. And how did they get to the subtotal? They most likely said this plus this plus this plus this. So when we look at this, we take the cost of the wheelbarrows plus the cost of the cement plus the cost of the shovels plus the cost of the river sand. And then we get to the same subtotal. Now, where will you get your marks? You will get an RT mark for using the correct values. So you're not using the price for one because you see they bought three wheelbarrows or four shovels. We're using the total cost for wheelbarrows plus the total cost for cement. So that's why we get the RT there and we get the MA for adding it all together. So show you how easy it actually is for us to get marks when we read and extract the information from the table. Now, you won't get a mark for the answer because they asked us to show how they got to the answer. But it's not a negative thing because it means it gives you a chance to check if your answer is actually correct. Now, the next concept we are going to look at is that.
So let's have a look at the VAT question that they have asked. Petra Shabanga bought material from a local hardware store. Annexure A shows the invoice of the purchase. Now, what does the acronym for VAT stand for? I know that you all know this by now. And they like asking this in the papers. So VAT stands for value added tax, right? And that's a nice, easy 2 marks that you can get. Petra Shabanga bought material from, that is the context. Show how the VAT amount was calculated. Now you will see here at the bottom, there's a subtotal. And let me just get my laser point. There's a subtotal here, and here is the VAT amount, right? So you have to show how. They're not interested in the answer because that's given, right? You need to show how they got to that. Now, we all know by now that VAT in South Africa is calculated at 15%. You will see at the bottom of my screen, there's a little formula that I like teaching my students. And the formula is the amount, so the 6,364.10, times what you want. I want 15% and what you have, right? So we've got 100% of the price. So the amount is that times by 15 over 100 gives you the 954,62. So you will see that you get an accuracy mark by multiplying, and then the method accuracy is for the 15%. And if you know how to use this formula, you can apply it to any VAT question that you get. Let's have a look at the next question. Write down the amount payable in words. Now you've seen that I've highlighted amount payable here, and now I'm going to look for the amount payable in my invoice, right? So the amount is 7,318.72. Please make sure that you write everything in words. Don't write something with your numbers, right? You will see there, and that is it. Easy 2 marks from this. Now it's your turn. I'm going to give you 5 minutes for Act 2.1 to 2.4 and see what you do to find the answers. Okay, so your 5 minutes starts now. Good luck. Mr. Klute is a part-time lecturer at a local university, studies payslip on Annexure A, and use the questions that follow. Right, so we've got a payslip, right? It's so important to make sense of the context that you have and have a look at the payslip first before you even answer the questions. We've got the employee name, Mr. Klute, the employee's number. So I've highlighted for myself employee number, which is over here. And so I've got that already over there, which is 2500453. Now this is the level one question, which is very easy, 2 marks. Right, let's move on to the next question. Mr. Klute contributes 9.25% of his basic salary towards his pension fund every month. Calculate the missing value A, Mr. Klute's monthly pension contribution. Right. Now, if you look at his basic salary, they say that he contributes 9.25% of his basic salary. His basic salary is 15,000 Rand. I have highlighted that for myself, as well as the 9.25%. So what does this word of means in mathematical terms? So we know that we need to multiply to get that 9.25%. Percent being over 100. So your calculation should be the 9.25 over 100 times with the 15,000 Rand should give you 1,387.50. I hope that all of you got that. Look at this. It's 3 marks. One for the method that you are using. Then that RT marks means reading from a table. So just for getting the 15,000, you are getting a mark. And then, of course, it is accuracy marks, which means we are looking for the correct answer. Please make sure your calculator, you're going to see comma 5, right? Please make sure that you put the zero behind to make it a 50 cents, right? If it was 5 cents, it would have been comma 05. So it's your responsibility to put that zero. Okay, I'm going to move on to the next question. Calculate B, the total deductions as shown on the payslip. Okay, so you have just calculated the pension, that A value that you were supposed to fill in there just to help yourself. The pension is then 1387.50. The total deductions will then be all of these values added up together. The 1675 plus the 150 plus his medical aid of 3,680 plus the pension, and that will give you the value for B. I hope that all of you got the 6,892.50. Okay. And let's go then to the fourth question here, 2.4. Sorry, let's just see what the marks was allocated for. It was for adding up your values correctly and then the answer you got. Okay, so the fourth question here was calculate C, the net salary as shown on his payslip. Right, now you will see they talk about a gross salary, that is 15,000. Now we have all the deductions. You have calculated the total deductions as 6,892.50. And a way for you to remember the net salary is, if you think about a picture of a net, right? And everything goes through here. Then you have what is left over. And what I mean by that is this is the gross salary that you can put in here minus all the deductions. And the net salary is then what we call his take-home pay or what is left over. So that's the 15,000 Rand then minus the deductions of 6,892.50, which should give you a net salary of 8,107.50. I hope that all of you got to that answer. You will see that it's only for 2 marks. Okay. Now let's have a look at how to approach a level 4 question. So up to this point, we have dealt with level 1 questions. Jana took you through a few of those. We have looked at level 2 questions, which involves more than just reading some information off a table. Level 3 will also be multiple steps, but with a level 4 question, you will have to do a little bit more. To get those marks. Now you will see the mark allocation for level 4 questions is always, it's going to be 4 marks, 5 marks, up to 6 marks, right? And the question we're going to look at is for 5 marks now. Now let's have a look at the context. Mr. Kluter, his spouse, and their 2 children. So we are talking about 4 people. I've labeled it for you, Mr. Kluter, his spouse, and then 2 children. Are considering changing to a different medical scheme. He finds the following option online. Mr. Kluter states that this will be a financially beneficial option. In other words, he's going to save money with the medical aid that he is looking into now. Now, you have to critically comment on his statement by showing all necessary calculations. Now, when you have to critically comment, you have to compare the 2 options and you will have to state whether his claim is valid or not valid, if he is going to save money or he's not going to save money. And we will not just give a mark for you saying, yes, he's going to save money. You have to show us why do you say he is going to save some money. Now, let's have a look at So the new option over here, it says the principal member is going to pay 1,416. That's for himself. And for the adult dependent, which is his spouse, he's going to pay that 1,416. So it's 2 of them, right? Now, he states in the scenario that there are 2 children, right? So it's 2 times, so 366 Rand. Now you'll see in the solution that they have added these 4 numbers up and got to 3,564 Rand. But look at the medical aid that he is currently paying. He's paying 3,680. So the difference between the two are the 3,680 minus the new one, which is 3,564. So he is going to save 116 Rand. So therefore, you have to make the comment then that you're critically comment. You have analyzed the 2. You have compared them. And now you can say it will be financially beneficial to go with the new option. Okay, because then the total monthly contribution is less. Have a look where the marks are allocated. The fact that you are reading from a table, the RT marks, that's the 1416, as well as the 366, your method accuracy, so adding these 4 values up together. And of course, you could have said 1416 times 2 plus 366 times 2 and got to the same answer, right? Then for the difference that you are showing and for the opinion that you, these 2 opinion marks that you are saying, it will be a financial beneficial option because he's going to pay less, right? I hope that that makes sense to you and that you can see if you break it up into smaller chunks, take your time, understand the question and answer it critically, it's actually an easy 5 marks. Don't be intimidated by the fact that you see 5 marks and what must you do now. Just break it up into smaller chunks and answer it step by step. Okay, now income tax. Let's have a look at income tax. It is in the paper every year in your paper one. So please make sure that you know how to work with personal income tax. It is an important part of the paper, and mostly they will give level 3, level 4 questions that comes from this. So let's have a look. Christina, age 43, please have a look at, I have highlighted 43. You can highlight 43 for yourself. I wonder if you know why this is important. And if you were thinking tax rebates, you are 100% correct. That is why age is important. Now, Christina earns a basic monthly salary of 32,907 rand and 50 cents. That is also important. Please highlight that for yourself. Some of the following deductions are indicated on her January 2023 payslip. Pension fund is equal to 7.5%. And then income tax payable to SARS. Annexure B, I hope that you have Annexure B open next to you. It's at the bottom of page 7. And it says, and it shows the 2022-23 income tax tables used to determine the taxpayer's tax payable. So if you look at this, your rates of tax are given, right? Here are the brackets that they look at, where the person fall into. And this, you will see over here, the rates of tax are the formulas that they work with to calculate a tax payable. Okay, we spoke about the tax rebates. This has got to do with the age. If you are younger than 65, they give a tax relief of 16,425. So we're going to deduct that at the very end. If the person is 65 and older, you can add them up together and deduct both of them. If the person is 75 and older, they get a relief of all three brackets, right? So I hope that you can still remember this and that you have studied this for your prelims. Right. Now let's look at the questions that they've asked. The first question is, calculate Christina's monthly pension fund deduction. Okay, so now we're going to go back to our scenario. We're going to look at the pension fund. The 7.5% is very important. And of course, you're going to use her monthly salary. So how would we use that? We're going to say 32,907.50 times the 7.5%. Remember, percentage is always over 100. So the tax, the pension payable is then 2468.06. You get a mark for method accuracy, multiplying with the 7.5%. And that accuracy mark is then for the answer that you have calculated. We're going to use Annexure B for the next one. But this is like VAT, right? What does the acronym, this will be a level one. What does SARS stand for? Guys, this is an easy 2 marks that is guaranteed. Please go and study your acronyms. SARS will be South African Revenue Service. 2 marks, easy 2 marks that all of you can definitely get. Okay. Now, Christina earns a taxable income of, I've highlighted the amount for you, the 365,079 rand per annum. So what does per annum mean? You can put into brackets next to it per year. Please remember that we will never work with her basic monthly salary to see where she fits into the tax table. You will see the large numbers. Therefore, we are working with the annual salary. Okay. And because she is paying pension fund, you can deduct the annual pension fund contribution if you have to calculate something like that. I've just put the formula here for you. So taxable income is equal to the annual salary minus the annual pension fund contribution. But they were so kind to give you the taxable income here. So you don't have to do any calculation. I'm just showing you this. It's just the extra note that I've added if you have to calculate the taxable income. All right. Okay, so let's see what is the question that they ask you. They're asking, identify which tax bracket Christina falls in based on a taxable income, right? So if you look at a taxable income, it's this green one over here, 365,079 rand. Can it be in the first bracket? No, because it only goes up to the 237 rand, 237,100 rand, right? So you need to go into the second tax bracket. Does the 365,079 fall into this one? Yes, it does. Therefore, I've highlighted that. And that's all they're asking. They're not asking you the rate of tax, just the tax bracket, right? So all you need to copy down is that one over there. Look at that. Easy 2 marks. Just identify where that fits into. I'm sure that all of you will be able to get that. Okay, now we're getting to a into the tax a little bit, and I would like you to do activity 3.3b. Okay, and I'm going to give you 5 minutes to complete that. Just before I go on, I just want you to note on my screen currently, for the personal income tax, I just did a quick check. Make sure that you have your taxable income. What is taxable income? The annual income minus your pension. Decide which rate of tax bracket to use. Remember, that is the brackets, the table that you see in front of you. After that, you want to look at the rebate. What does the person qualify for? Is the person younger than 65, older than 65, or is the person older than 75, right? That is the rebates that you're looking at. And very lastly, we're going to look at the medical aid credits if necessary. All right, so this is just a note for yourself, but let's move on to the question that was asked. Okay, so you've got Christina's taxable income of the 365,079 rand per annum. They ask you to calculate the amount of tax Christina must pay for the 2022-23 tax year. So the first thing you have done is you had a look at where does Christina fit into the, let me just get my highlighter quickly. Where does she fit into our tax table? And we have agreed she fits into the tax table into the second step over there. So you want to look across and you want to look at the rates of tax that she is charged. So I want you to highlight this because this is also what you are going to use, right? Okay, so that is then where you are supposed to start. The 42,678 I've copied from there plus 26%. Open up your bracket because now you need to get the difference of the income above this amount over here, the 237,100, right? So you need to write down, you opened your bracket, the 365,079 minus the 237,000 rand with this 100 over here, right? So then you close your bracket, you simplify it. You don't have to simplify, you can just punch everything into your calculator into one step. And then you will get the answer of 75,952 rand 54 cents. Okay. So I hope that all of you got up to this third mark over here, right? Where does this minus 16,425 rand come from? You will see that I've highlighted that in purple. So now she gets a bit of a relief. This is the state's way to give us a bit of a relief, the rebate, and she only qualifies for a primary rebate, so you can deduct that. So what is the amount that she pays at the end of the day? That will be the 59,527 rand 54 cents. So just have a look where the marks are allocated. The first mark is for substituting into a formula, right? And you got the formula over here. The second mark is for simplifying, right? Your third mark is for the answer you got. Then minusing your rebate. And lastly, this is for the answer. You will see a CA mark. CA means a calculation accuracy. So we work with whatever you got here minus the correct rebate will give you the answer here. So we will work with a mistake if you have made one, a rounding mistake or something up earlier. All right. Remember, when we are working with money, always round to two decimal places. I just want to say, if you have any questions, please put it in the comments. You know, if you have any questions, please put it in the chat and I will try and answer it as soon as possible. Okay, so I was thinking at 9 o'clock, I want to give you a little break, which is in 3 minutes. Let's just have a look at exchange rates before we go on a little break. So we all know what an exchange rate is. Let's have a look. So if you can remember, you got this in your prelims as well. How much money can you get for your rand in another country? If you travel to England, for example, how much pounds can you get? We know that the pound is stronger than the rand, so you're going to need a lot of rands to go to England and to get some pounds, right? Just have a look at the currencies that were given to you in this example. In activity 4, you've got the Japanese yen, the US dollars, the Brazilian real, and the British pound. Okay, and units per ZAR. In other words, ZAR is a South African rand, of course. So for 1 rand, you can get so much Japanese yen. For 1 rand, you can get so much US dollar. Okay. Which is not a lot. And if you look at the ZAR per unit, it means then $1, let's just look at the second one over here. For $1, you can get 18 rand, 068562. Okay, let's look at the pound, which is the strongest in this example. For £1, you can get 20,305594 rands. Okay, so the first question that they ask here, let's just quickly look at the question post. Christina's sister works in Brazil. On Christina's birthday, her sister sends her 550 Brazilian real. You will see that is what they've used here. It's Brazilian real. The table below shows the currency conversion factors for a few of the currencies in terms of South African currency on the 30th of March, 2023. The first question is, identify the currency that is second strongest to the rand. I think you can all see this is the first strongest, and the second strongest will then be the 18,06, in other words, the US dollar or American dollar, and that is for 2 marks. Okay, let's have a look at the second question here. Show how the British pound of 0,044832 ZAR per unit was determined. So let's just go to the British pound. This is the one that they are talking about, ZAR per unit. So how would you be able to get to this answer over here from that? If this is how much rand you are getting for £1. I hope that you have your calculator next to you. You want to say 1 divided by the 20,305,594. Just see if you get to that answer quickly. 1 divided by 20,305,594, and that will give you the 0,044832. I think you got almost the same type of question in your prelim paper, in paper 1, now in September. And then the last question before we take a little bit of a break. I'm going to just give you 3 minutes and then we'll take a break, is activity 4.3. And the question is, determine how much money Christina received in Rand from her sister. Now, remember, we read the context already. On Christina's birthday, her sister sends her 550 Brazilian real. Okay, so quickly calculate for me, what would you do to determine how much money she is getting in Rand? Okay, I'll give you a minute. You will see here at the bottom right of my screen, this is something that I tell my matrix. When the units are different, for example, the Brazilian real and the rand, you will multiply or times. And when the units are the same, if you're working in rand and rand, you will divide. Okay. So I think I actually helped you a little bit now. So with the exchange rate, you are either going to multiply or you are going to divide. You need to decide which operation to use. In this example, we are talking about the Brazilian real and rand, which is two different units. Therefore, we are going to multiply. Okay, so we are going to multiply by the 3,518097. And I hope that you all got 1,934.95. Okay, let's start with tariffs. I was busy saying, I see the one that we are currently going to look at is an electricity tariff example. Please, learners, remember that we get different types of tariffs. We get water tariffs. Make sure that you know how to use them. The sliding scale, for example, on the water tariffs. We get parking tariffs. We get all type of different tariffs. So you have to familiarize yourself with all the different contexts. But unfortunately, we can only look at this example today. Let's go through the example together. Christina owns a 4-bedroom apartment or a 4-room apartment in Durban with a bathroom and toilet. The apartment uses 1 light bulb per room. Let me just get my highlighter. The apartment uses 1 light bulb per room. So there's 1 light bulb for the bathroom, 1 light bulb for the toilet. The current tariff is 188.63 cents per kilowatt hours, VAT inclusive. That's also important that you note that. The table below shows the cost of using some appliances. Okay, so they're talking about a laptop charger, the lightning. We are currently looking at the lightning. Okay, they say the rating, the hours used, days used per month, and the kilowatt hour used per month is 18. Monthly cost per unit is R41.81. Now they say use the table and the information above to answer the questions that follow. Define the term tariff. Now, when we define, I think Jana told you that we are looking at a level 1 question, right? In the given context. Okay, so it's important that you look at the context, that we are working with electricity, and that you define the tariff term in terms of what's been used here. So tariff is the cost charged per kilowatt hour. All right,
So it was important that you use the electricity, the kilowatt per kilowatt hour in your definition. And that will give you 2 marks. Calculate the total monthly cost for lighting in Christina's apartment. Now, it's important that you know that we've got this 4-room apartment with a bathroom and toilet. So in total, we've got 6 rooms that's using a light bulb. It's the 4 rooms plus the bathroom plus the toilet, right? And they state here that it's 1 light bulb in the per room. And then there's a light bulb for the bathroom and for the toilet. If you look at the monthly cost, it's the R41.81. And there you see that is where the 6 times R41.81 come from. 1 mark for accuracy that you identify the 6 times with the R41.81. And then you get your mark for the answer. Okay, so that's a nice and easy question. I would like you to do activity 5.3 on your own now. So I've done 5.1 and 5.2 for you. You will see that 5.3 is for 6 marks. And I would like you to try this one on your own.
Okay, now let's have a look at the question. It says the total cost for Christina for all the appliances, excluding 6 light bulbs, stove, and 3 laptop chargers, is R1,115.35. Okay. Christina claims that the total monthly cost, including 6 light bulbs, stove, and 3 laptops, will be more than R1,952. Verify showing all calculations if her claim is valid. I wonder if the learners can tell me which level question this would be. If you are saying a level 4, you are 100% correct, because it says that you must verify. If you have to verify or critically comment, we are looking at a level 4 question. You'll also see that this question is for 6 marks. So you have to break it up into smaller chunks and look at what are they asking. Okay, so the first bit of information is telling us the cost for all the appliances, but excluding the light bulbs, the stove, and the laptop charges are so much. Okay, then she claims that the total, including the six light bulbs, the stove, and 3 laptops, will be more than 1,952. So you need to state if this is true. In other words, is her claim valid or invalid? All right. So let's quickly look at the laptop charger in your table, right? Let me just get my pointer. The laptop charger over here, you will see cost R3.05 per month. Remember that there are 3. Also, the stove, it's a 4-plate stove. The monthly cost, now you will see that there's a larger plate at the back, a back small plate, a front large plate, a front small plate, but this is all the stove. So you will have to add all of these values up. Please remember in the previous question, we already answered what the 6 light bulbs are using per month, the electricity used. So that is something that you can just bring down from the previous, the 6 light bulbs. Would be your R41.81 times the 6 gives R250.86. We've already calculated that, right? The stove, all the plates added up together that I've highlighted over here for you, right? These values are added up together to give the total for what the stove is using for the month. And then the 3 laptop charges that I showed you in the beginning when we started, the laptop charges is this R3.05. There are 3 laptop charges cost R9.15. So I broke up the 6 light bulbs, the stoves, the 3 laptop charges, and then the answers to that. I just quickly want to get my highlighter. The answers to that, the 250 rand 86, the 420 rand 21 rand 57, and the 9 rand 15, this all added up together. And remember, don't forget that she already has the 1,115 rand 35 cents. That is where that come from, right? So plus the additional, including these three totals, she gets to 1,796 rand 93 cents. But what did she claim? What was the statement? She said that it will be more than 1,952. Is that more? No, it is not. So you have to state then, to get your final marks, that her claim is invalid. Please have a look at the mark allocation for the 6 marks. There's a mark for adding up all the stove plates, then the answer you got there, a mark for the laptop charges, a mark for the total that you got there and that you added up the totals, and then obviously your last mark will go towards the claim, whether it is valid or invalid. Okay, I hope that you all got to this answer. If not, I hope that you saw where you made your mistake. I think it's the only thing is that you had to remember to add this 1,115.35. Okay, I'm going to move on to the next question. Christina states that if she uses the geyser for 2 hours a day for 30 days and the back large plate and the front small plate of the stove once, the electricity bill will decrease by exactly 450 rand. Verify showing all calculations whether her claim is valid. So there's another 5 minutes for this problem over here. I would like you to try this one on your own. Okay, so I've read the problem to you before you got started. I would just like to know whether you have recognized that this is a level 4 question again, because it says verify showing all calculations whether her claim is valid or invalid. So I hope after all your calculations, you have verified and that you said that it's valid or invalid. Now let's quickly have a look. So Christina states that if she uses the geyser for 2 hours a day for 30 days. Okay, now let's quickly go to the geyser. The geyser is listed over here. It says that she uses the geyser hours used per day, 5 hours, right? But we are only going to use 2 out of the 5 hours. And it says already for 30 days, right? So how am I going to calculate her monthly cost if we are only going to use 2 out of the 5? So I hope that you have put 2/5, right, times by the 628.20. Then she says she's only going to use the back large plate of her stove. So the back large plate of her stove is going to cost 151.35. And she's going to use the small front plate. Okay, which is going to be front small plate 29.41. And let's see what that will equal to. So 2/5 or 2/5 times the 628.20 gives you 251.28. I hope you got that, right? And the 2 plates for the stove, I've showed you where that comes from, is 180.76. So what is the total cost that she's going to pay? It's the 251.28 plus the 180.76 gets to or comes to 432.04. Now she is saying the electricity bill will decrease by exactly 450 rand. Is it increasing by that amount exactly? No, it's not, right? It's not 450 on the dot. So therefore, the claim is not valid. Please note where the marks are given. one multiplying by the 2/5, one for the simplification or giving the answer, one mark for your stove's plate added up together, one mark for the total cost, and one mark for your opinion, which is not valid. Okay, I hope you got 4, 5 out of 5 there, and that you see that it's not that difficult to answer a level 4 question. I'm sure that if you break it up into smaller parts and understand what you are reading, you will be able to get full marks there. Okay, so let's just do a quick break. I'm not going to take the full 5 minutes here just to get through everything. But let's get started. Tell the person to your left one thing that you have learned today. Only one thing. Then ask the person to your right one definition from finance. I'll give you a minute to do that. And then, learners, please give your teacher that is with you today one compliment. Just one. I wish I could hear some of the compliments you are giving your teacher. And then lastly, just while you are where you are seated, have a little stretch. Just stretch your arms above your head. And maybe your legs a little bit. And then we are going to move on to the next section of the work, which is data. So when Jana started the session in the very beginning, she told you what paper one will look like, right? Finance is the biggest part of your paper one, which is about 60%. But data handling is the second biggest chunk of paper one, and that's about 35% of your paper will be data handling. Data is also a very nice place where you can make up or get a lot of marks, just because I feel that data, if you know all your theory, you can only do well. Right, so let's quickly see sections that can be tested. It's developing questions, collecting the data. After we've collected the data, we classify and organize the data. Then we summarize the data. You know all the ways that we can summarize the data. Then we represent the data, that is with all our graphs. And then we analyze the data. What is the data actually telling us? Let's get into this straight away. If you go to your activity one or act one, you will see that it's on page 10, right? You will see a little graph on Annexure A, and the heading is the medium-term gross taxable revenue outlook in billions. Okay, so if you look at the graph over here, there's a budget for 2023, and a budget for 2022. So all these blue boxes or bars in the double bar graph here is the budget for 23, and the dotted bit is the budget for 2022. Please note, learners, even though the y-axis only has 500 over year and 1,000, it is representing billions. So yes, just when you give your answers, make sure that it's in billions, right? And then obviously we spoke about the x-axis, which is your horizontal one, represents the years. I have highlighted in green the budget for 2023, and then the budget for 2022 is highlighted in the purple. So you will see that I've made a note here at the bottom, and I hope that you all know this by now. I can almost guarantee a question like this. What is discrete data? Discrete data is numbers that can be counted. In other words, the number of people or students sitting in your classroom right now. That would be an example of discrete, right? People can be counted. Animals can be counted. Cars can be counted. Anything that you can think of that can be counted. The number of goals scored in a soccer match. That will all be discrete data. Now, when we look at continuous data, that is data that can be measured or weighed. In other words, those are the data with commas, decimals, right? So if you look at the data that's displayed over there, is the data displayed on the graph discrete or continuous data? What do you say? Yes, continuous is correct because there are commas. Guys, if you know this, it's 2 marks straight away. It's as easy as whole numbers or do you have commas? If it's whole numbers, discrete, commas, continuous. Please remember this. This is easy 2 marks. Let's move on. Write the amount for budget outlook 2023 of 2022-2023 in full digit number. Okay, so I'm going to look at this one. Now, this one is a little bit confusing. Even though it says 2022-2023, we have to look at the budget for 2023, which is this bar over here, right? Sorry, I'm going to try my best. Okay, so you are supposed to write this out in numbers. Now, at the bottom, I made a little note for you. We know that thousands has got 3 zeros, 10,000s, 4 zeros, 100,000s, 5 zeros, 1 million, 6 zeros, 1 billion is 9 zeros. Okay, doesn't mean that you can just put this down and put 9 zeros, right? It doesn't work like that. All of these numbers are part of your billion. Okay, how many zeros do we still need after we have done this? So they are 1, 2, 3, 4. So we are going to use 1, 2, 3, 4. So we are still going to need 5 zeros. Oh, I'm lying. Sorry, 6 plus 2. We're still going to need 8 zeros. Sorry about that. So it's 1,692,000,000. Nay. Yeah, so just make sure that you can write this out in your numbers. Learners, I also want to mention to you that we don't use commas in between our numbers, right? You want to just use a space as a separator. So let's just go back to this. The 1692, there's your 1692, comma 2. Right? After that, you want to start your, make sure that you have your 9 spaces. I hope this makes sense, what I'm currently trying to say to you, that you have your 9 spaces there, but that comma 2 then forms part of the 0. So therefore, you still need 8 zeros over there. Sorry about that I said 6, it's the 8 zeros. Okay, so 2 accuracy marks here. Activity 2, let's just have a look. Activity 2 is on the next page, on page 11. Let's quickly have a look at the scenario there. I'm going to give you 5 minutes to quickly do that. You will see that it's only for 2 marks, which means that it's level 1 question. The school governing body wants to pave the area from the gate to the staff room and to the classes. They instructed the principal to get quotations for paving bricks from different service providers. The following prices per paving brick and rand, including VAT, were quoted. Okay, so if you look on your notes, I would like you to arrange the following data in ascending order. I think I'm not going to give you 5 minutes for that. I'm just going to give you 2 minutes, and then we will go through this question by question. Okay, learners, your 2 minutes is over. So arranging in ascending order, make sure that you've arranged it from small to big. I always think about an aeroplane that is lifting off, so from a small altitude to a bigger one. And when we talk about descending, so a plane that descends come from big to small. All right, so let's see if you've got this order. 3.09, 3.20, 3.25, 3.26, 3.45, 3.50, 3.65, 3.85, and 3.91. I hope that you all got that. That's a nice and easy question for 2 marks. Right, let's have a look at the next question. Identify the second highest value. So if 3.91 is your highest value, your second highest value will of course be 3.85 rand. Okay, I hope you all could identify that. Identify the median price for the collected prices. Now, what does median mean? Can you all remember that median means the middle number? But you can only find the middle number once you have arranged it from small to big. So let's quickly count how many values do we have. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So it's an uneven data set. So what would the middle number be? If you count 4 in, 1, 2, 3, 4, then this is the fifth value. So there must be 4 values on this side of it, and then 4 values on the other side of the 3.45. So I hope that you will agree with me that 3.45 is our median. Right. Let's have a look at the following question. Okay, we already had a question like this, so let's quickly see if you can get this one. Is the data of the prices discrete or continuous? It's got commas, so what will it be? Of course, we know now that it is continuous data, right? Because it's got the commas. Determine the mode of the collected prices. Now, what does mode mean? Who can remember what does mode mean? The number that occurs the most. Now, if you looked at the values, do you see any value twice, for example, or 3 times? No. Guys, no mode is also an answer. So there are no mode, you write down no mode, 2 marks for that. Okay, then how many quotes for paving bricks were received from the service providers? So Utah had to go and count. If you just read the context again, it says the following prices were quoted. Right, so how many prices were quoted? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There were 9 prices quoted. And for doing that, it is 2 marks. The easy 2 marks. Okay, let's go over to activity 3. You will find that on page 12. Okay, the table below shows an extract of the provincial mid-year population estimates by age and gender for 2021 for selected provinces. All right, let's just quickly have a look at what provinces are mentioned. Eastern Cape is mentioned, Gauteng is mentioned, and KwaZulu-Natal. In each one of them, it's broken up into a male, female, Gauteng, male and female, as well as KwaZulu-Natal, with the ages on the left-hand side, right? So this is what we call a two-way table. The question asked is calculate the total number of females in the 10 to 19 years old age group in the 3 provinces. So they want to know all 3 provinces. They want to know the females. So I'm going to look at my females only in all 3 the provinces. And they want to know age 10 to 19. Age 10 to 14 is over there and 15 to 19. So I basically have to add up then the females. 10 to 14 is that amount for Eastern Cape. 15 to 19, the 369258, plus the females in this age group added up together, as well as the females in KwaZulu-Natal for that age group. If you add up all these numbers together, you will see there's the 365, the 369 that I showed you where it comes from, the 652, the 522, the 575, and the 512333. Will give you 297160. There are 3 marks allocated for that. 2 RT marks, that means that it is from the table, or 1 RT mark, correct values, all 6. 1 method mark, adding the values, and 1 mark for the simplification. Okay. Now, as you know, we're going to make it your turn, but you will see that 3.2 is a probability question. Now, probability makes about 5% of your paper 1 as well as your paper 2. Remember how we find probability? It is the number of favorable outcomes over the number of all the possible outcomes. So if you can do 3.2 quickly on your own, it's in your pack on page 12. I will mark it with you in the next 3 minutes. All right, everybody, your 3 minutes is over. Let's quickly see what did you do with this activity 3. Determine as a percentage, that's important that they're asking a percentage, the probability of randomly selecting a female in the 25 to 29 age interval residing in the Eastern Cape out of all the women in the Eastern Cape. Right, so I am going to go to the Eastern Cape. I've highlighted that in purple. I'm going to go to the age interval of 25 to 29. We are specifically looking for the females. Now, earlier, before you started it, I said that probability is the number of favorable outcomes. In other words, you have to take this number, the 216,888, over all the possible outcomes. So you were supposed to add up all these numbers to get the total, times with 100 to take it to a percentage, right? And your answer should be 8.99%. I hope that all of you got that. So where was the marks allocated? The first mark was allocated for your numerator, the 260,000. That one over there, 888. Then for your denominator, that would be the 2412376, right? That you have calculated, and then the CA mark is for the simplification. Okay, I hope that you understand where all the values come from and that you see that probability is easy to answer. Right, let's have a look at 3.3. It says determine the median number of men in Gauteng. The median number. So I'm going to give you 3 minutes to quickly calculate that. That is on your pages. I'll share my screen with you in 3 minutes. Okay, righty, let's quickly mark it. Your 3 minutes is over. I just want to remind you, when we are looking for the median number, you cannot find the median if you have not arranged the data from small to big. This is very important, learners. You can't just go and look for the middle number. You have to put it in ascending order, all the data. Right. So you will get a mark for arranging it in ascending order. You will see where we have started, and we are specifically looking for the males in Gauteng, which is this column over here. Right. This started with the smallest number, 557532. And so I have arranged it until the biggest number, 745325. Right. I hope that all of you did that. Now, if they ask for the median, Median means the middle number. Now, this is an example of an even data set, right? There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 numbers in this data set. Okay, so what do we do if we have two values that's in the middle? I'm going to count my four values in, 1, 2, 3, 4. So I'm going to use this number over here, and then the same from the back, 1, 2, 3, 4, which is this one over here. Okay, so how do I find the middle of these two values? I hope that you know this by now. We are going to add these two values up together and divide the answer by 2 to get the middle. So it's the 654,456 plus the 665,455. That answer I divide by 2, and that should give you a 659,955,5. But you are not actually done, because we are working with people. I would like you to please round it up for me to 659,956, right? We can't get half a mile. We have to round it up. Okay, so where will the marks be allocated? The first one was for the arrangement. The second one is the concept of mean. Sorry, that accuracy mark is now there on top. It's actually for the arrangement. And then the third mark is for the simplification. In other words, for your answer. But the answer, I hope that you wrote it in by your answer to round it to a whole number. And we round it to the 659,956, please. Okay. I have made a note here on the bottom right of the screen. Remember that the median is the middle number in a data set, and you have to arrange from small to big before you can choose it. If there are two numbers in the middle, remember that we add them up together and divide them by 2. All right, so let's move on to the next question. Question 3.4 is an interesting one. It's also the last question on that page. It says calculate the value of B if the mean value for men in KwaZulu-Natal is 520,244. Okay, so you got a question like this in the prelims, if I can remember correctly. They actually left out two values. It was Q and Q. So I can almost guarantee that you would get something like this in your finals as well. So please take this 5 minutes, apply yourself with 3.4, and then we will mark it together. Your 5 minutes starts now with activity 3.4. Okay, so the question was, calculate the value of B if the mean value for men in KwaZulu-Natal is 520,244. Now you will see that I've highlighted the word mean, and another word for mean is obviously average. How do we calculate average? We will add all the values up together, right? And then we divide it by how many values there are. So if you count with me, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There are 8 values in total, right? We do not know what B is, but we do know what the mean is equal to. So it's important that if you add all these values up, and I know that you did, and that you got to this answer over here, plus B. We don't know what B is, right? But you must put it into your formula. So the answer to the mean is 520,244. So you're supposed to put it in here, okay, is equal to the values that you have added up together gives you that answer, plus B. We're going to figure out what B is now, divided by 8. You are showing your mark, or whoever's going to mark your paper, just by adding this up and dividing by 8, that you understand the concept of a mean, which is the average of the males of, we are specifically looking of KwaZulu-Natal. Okay. How do you get rid? So you want to ultimately get B alone. So this is actually a linear equation, right? So this takes you back to grade 9 mathematics. So you have to get rid of the 8 under the line. This line means divide by 8. So what is the inverse operation of division? Multiplication, right? So if you punch into your calculators, if you want to work with me, the 520,244 times by 8 will give you this 4,161,952, right? I hope you all got this answer on your calculators now. Is equal to, now you got rid of the 8, to this value over here, right? What you've added up together. But remember, we need to get B alone. Okay, how would you do that? So this 371,988, we need to get rid of that now. Okay, and how do you do that? You need to take it over the equal sign and subtract it from the 416,954. So if you can just quickly punch into your calculators 416,952 minus the 371,988, you should get to an answer of 489,964. I hope that you all got to that answer. Now let's quickly see how we would mark a question like this. You would get a mark for adding all the values up together, right? That is at the top, allocated here now, adding it all up together. Then for dividing by 8, right? This means the concept of a mean. Your next mark will be changing the subject of the formula. In other words, we are going to, you have gotten rid of the 8, okay? That was the S stands for the simplification. And then the B lastly is for the answer that you got it to be. So I hope that this makes a little bit more sense to you. You must practice questions like this because you will definitely see this. All right. Remember, what is a mean? Mean is the average. Just for substituting this into the formula, you will get a mark already. Adding it up, dividing it by the 8. Okay. How to get rid of the 8? You multiply the 8 with whatever's on the left-hand side of your formula. Then get B alone, take this number over, minus it from your bigger number, and you get to the answer. So it is definitely doable, and I believe that all of you will be able to answer a question like this. Okay. I wonder if you would like to take a 5-minute body break just to stretch a little bit, and then I will continue in about 5 minutes with the next activity. Okay, so I'm going to give you 5 minutes just to do a stretch, and then we will be back. And that we can get started. We are almost done with today's session. I just want to, before I move on, just say to the learners that unfortunately we do not have time to go over everything that you have done with data handling, but please don't forget to go over your quartiles. That's important, and also the percentiles. I am going to move on now to activity 5 in your booklet that is on page 15. You will see that there's a pie chart. Let's quickly read the context. The adjusted budget vote speech for 2022-2023 was recently held virtually. The pie chart below shows the allocation for conditional grants from the total basic education budget. Right, then you will see that the pie chart is divided up into sectors. The biggest one being infrastructure, with 53% of the budget is going towards infrastructure. Then let's have a look at the second highest, that is NSNP. You will see at the bottom there's a little table with your acronyms in it. That stands for the National School Nutrition Program. Our third highest is the 5% ECD, which stands for early childhood development. And so we can go on up to the 1%, which is HIV/AIDS and TB prevention. Okay, the first question that they ask us there, identify the sector with the third highest grant allocation. So just by making sense of my pie chart, before I even looked at my questions, I can now answer that question easily. And I saw that my third highest grant was for early childhood development. You can just write down the ECD. We said that the first one was the infrastructure, second one was the NSNP, and then the third one is, of course, the early childhood development ECD. Okay, let's have a look at 5.2. Sorry, that's 2 marks just for identifying a nice level one question. Okay, this would be the last 5 minutes that I'm going to give you before we are done with today's session. So I really want you to apply yourself with this question, and then you will see that it's a level four question. Verify through calculations if her statement is valid or not. I'm not going to read it for you. I would like you to make sense of the problem yourself, and then I will come back to it. So your 5 minutes to do 5.2 starts now, and then we will mark it afterwards. Good luck. Let's quickly see what you have done with this activity 5.2. Okay, so Kaylin, we have read this already. Kaylin works in the infrastructure sector and saw on the budget speech that the sector received a 5.6 increase from the previous year. Okay, so we are going to look at infrastructure. Kaylin states that the budget allocated for the previous year was more than 11,000 million rand. Verify through your calculations if her statement is valid. Okay, now if you go back to the heading of this, you will see that the grant is for 23 billion rand. Okay, so you had to work with infrastructure and the 23 billion rand. Okay, so your first calculation should be 53% of the 23 billion. You can just write billion out in words. You don't have to add all the zeros. Okay, if you punch this into your calculator, or you could have said 53 over 100 times 23, you will get 12.19. Remember to write the billion afterwards, rand. Okay, but we want to know, the statement was, Kaylin state that the budget allocated for the previous year was more than 11,000 million. Okay, so now you have to either divide by 1,056 to see what the amount was the previous year. Or remember, I gave you a little formula earlier today where it was what you want. I only want 100%. Of what is given over what we have, right? I only want 100% over what we have. So we have the 100% plus the 5.6%, all right? And I want the amount before, which is then 11,54 billion, but we have to move our comma on because we want the answer in millions, right? And then a statement said that it was more than 11,000 million, then you can see this is more than 11,000 million, and therefore you have to say that the statement is valid. Valid. I hope that all of you got to this answer and that you remember to say whether a statement was valid or not. So let's see where the marks was allocated. The first mark was allocated for multiplying by 53%. You had to multiply the 53% by the 23 billion rand. Give yourself a mark for that. Then you got a mark for that answer. It's an accuracy mark. Then by dividing the 1,056 to see what the amount was before or multiply with your 100 over 105.6 was also an option, which would give you that answer. Then for taking your answer to millions, the conversion, and then of course you had to say whether the statement is valid or invalid, and that is the 6 marks. Learners, you can now get a break for 10 minutes because I know that you still have a question 4 that you need to go through in class. But before we go on a break for 10 minutes, I would like to know at this point if you have any questions for me. Okay, everybody, our 10 minutes is over and I'll try and answer the 3 questions that came up. And Jana said that she will also jump in if it's necessary to assist. Okay, so if I can just look at the questions asked, I'm going to start by 3.4. Then I will go to, I think it was 4.2. What was the other question?
3.4.
Okay. And then it was the 5.2, right?
Yes.
Okay. So this is question 3.4. I'm going to start here. And I'll just go over this again. The question was, calculate the value of B. If the mean value for men in KwaZulu-Natal is 520,244. Okay. So I hope that the learners know that the definition of the mean is that we add all the values up together and we divide it by how many values there are. So another word for mean, as I've stated, is the word average. Okay, But here we don't have one value. We don't have B, but we have the answer to the mean. We have got the mean. They told it's this answer. So if you write down your formula, you should add up all these values, right? And you have to write there plus B over or divide by how many values there are. We've counted that there are 8 values. Let me just quickly get my pointer. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 values. So if you put this into the formula, the answer is given, the 520,244 equal to all the values that you have added up together for the males of KwaZulu-Natal plus B divided by 8. You need to set up this formula on your own. It will not be given to you. But if you know what the mean is and how to find it, this should be easy. Adding up the values, divide by how many values there are. There's one unknown, so we do plus B. You have to put there. Okay? Now, you have to get B alone. That is your ultimate goal. How do you do that? You have to get rid of the 8 under the line. The opposite operation of division is multiplication. So I'm going to times. I would like you to take your calculator and work with me. Punch in 520,244 times by 8. If you punch that in, you should get the 4161952. Now you are rid of the 8, okay? But you still don't have B alone. In other words, you need to take this 3671988 over the equal sign. Now this is a positive number, so if it goes over the equal sign, it will turn into a minus. So now you have to punch in. You have 4161, the 1952 on your calculator now ready. Just minus the 3671988, and you should get the answer of 489,964. Can I just get an indication in the chat if this is clear, if you understand, or what is this that you don't understand? Is there something that I can explain better?
Is this, I think, okay? You can continue, Ms. Kuman. There's nothing okay in the chat.
Okay. Wonderful. The next one that I'm going to go to, was there a 3.4 that I've just done the 3.4, right?
4.2 and 5.2.
4.2. So I'm going to move on to the 4.2 now. 4.2.
Ms. Kuman, I think the 4.2 was the finance activity. So what I'm going to do quickly, I'll do 5.2 just quickly.
Okay.
For the colleague, I understand your question on 5.2, but remember, the same as the question that Ms. Kuman explained now, that was a reverse mean calculation. So this, if we look at what this question is saying, I just copied it into a Word document quickly, but the question was, where does the 1.056 come from? So if we look at this, I hope that everyone was clear that you had to work out the 53% of the total budget. So of the 23 billion, which would give you an answer in billions. So if you followed up until year, you would say 53% of 23 billion is 12.19 billion. So everyone should be up until year. That is the allocation for this year. But now the question said that she saw that the sector received a 5.6% increase from the previous year. So in other words, we have the new amount of this year, but we want to find the previous year. So we want to find the old amount. And now we must see if it is more than 11,000 million. So that is what then happened. So the new amount that we have is already going to be the 100. So it used to be 100%. And we don't know how much 100% was. But this new amount is, in other words, we added the 5.6%, is 105.6%. And that is going to be your 12,19 billion. Sorry for the handwriting. So 105.6% is the 12,19 billion rand. So in other words, if you now have to get that decimal, you can either now say 105.6 divide by 100. So we need to now know what we're working with. Sorry, 100 divided by 105.6 times with the amount, which was the method that ma'am had up on the board. Or we can now see that to make this into a decimal, you will say 105.6 and we divide that by 100. And then we get 1.056, which is similar to the method that we actually use when we are doing VAT calculations, when we go from including VAT to excluding VAT. So if you look at this, what we did here, you will now, if you were going to go forwards, you would multiply with 1.056, but because we are going backwards to the previous year, we are going to divide by the 1.056, or as the method that Ms. Kuman had up on the board, or on the presentation rather, she did have the, I think, the multiply or divide by 105.6 over 100. So she did show you the other method. So there's more than one method to get to the right answer. This is just a way that we got to this decimal over here. So Ms. Kuman, I don't know if you want to continue.
This one, show how the British pound of that per unit was determined. Am I right?
Yes, 4.2. Yeah.
Okay. So you have to go and look for the value of the British pound. Okay. And we want to know how was this determined, ZAR per unit. So remember when I said ZAR per unit, it means that for one of their units, what will they get in ZAR? Okay, so if you go to ZAR per unit, you will see for £1, for one British pound, they will get 20 rand and so much cents, right? But if we go to unit per ZAR, is this is what we will get. 1 rand is equal to so much pound. Okay, we know that the rand is not much against the pounds. So you know that you have to work with these two values. Okay. Now remember, you need to get from here your ZAR per unit to units per ZAR. That is what they're asking you, ZAR per unit. Okay, so here's our ZAR per unit. So I'm just going to highlight this. I would like you to highlight this with me. Okay, so you need to remember I said to you, there are two calculations with exchange rate. You need to decide, are you going to multiply to get to your answer or are you going to divide? Okay, and we're talking about one per. So how do we express one per? You're going to put it one over the 20.305. And so it goes on, right? Because 1 times 20 is just going to give you, anything times 1 is going to give you the same answer. But they're asking you show. Look at that word, show. So you have to do a calculation to show them how you got to the 0.044832. Therefore, 1 per, 1 zar will only give you 0.so much pound. I hope that this is clear and that this makes sense. Learners, punch into your calculator, please. 1/20.305594. Put your equal sign and see that you get to this answer. Okay. I think I can't make this more clear. I hope that this sorts it out. I'm not sure if there was another question.
Well, I think that was all the questions in the chat. Thanks, Ms. Kuman. You can continue.
Okay. So, activity 4 on page 13 is not going to be part of this slideshow, but we wanted the learners to do this as a little assessment, and then we can mark it afterwards. I think the session is supposed to end at 11:15. So I'm going to ask the learners to do this activity for, let's see how far they get in, say, 10 minutes. And then I will put the answers up on the board. I don't know if this is okay with you, Jana, or how we're going to go about this.
Hi, Ms. Kuman. Yeah, I think what we can do, I'm just checking the activity quickly. So maybe what we can do is we can give them 5 minutes to do 3.1 to 3.3, and then you can mark those, and then we continue like that.
Okay. Let's see how we go. Okay, so I'm going to give them 5 minutes, and then 4.1 to 4.3? Activity
4.1 to 4.3, yes.
Yes. Okay, perfect. Okay, thank you, Jana.
All right.
Okay, learners, so your 5 minutes starts now. Okay, learners, your 5 minutes is up. Let's quickly mark the first three. Okay, I hope that everybody can see my current screen that I am sharing. I'm going to go between the memo and the questions asked. Right. So I'm just going to read the scenario to you. Activity 4. Learners make use of various types of transport to get to the educational institutions. In 2022, data were collected by schools and submitted to the district and to the National Department of Education. According to the data, an estimate of 2,800,000, that's about 80.8% learners, use private transport, and the remaining 700,000, which is 19.2%, use government transport. Use the information above and Annex C, which is on page 14 in your packs, to answer the questions that follow. 4.1, name one statistical method that can be used to collect data. So this will be a level one type of question. How can you collect data, learners? You can either have a survey, a questionnaire, ask people how they get to school, right? A population census, document analysis, you can interview learners, you can research it. Any of these methods will give you 2 marks. Okay, let's look at the next question. Okay, sorry, let me just go back to 4.1, you were just supposed to mention one name, one statistical method. So I said a survey, a questionnaire, any of these ones. Okay, 3.1.2 on my memo, but it's 4.2 in the pack. You were supposed to express as a ratio in the form. There were 3 blanks filled out there. The number of Free State Government learner transport, private learner transport, and total respectively. So you were supposed to go to the Free State. I hope you can all see the values on the annexure. It's now a little bit difficult to flip between the two. 4.3, write down the number of Northwest learners who use private learner transport in 2022 as a percentage of the total learners. Okay, so I think we will have to have a look at the table in order to do these questions properly. I would like to go back to 4.2 quickly. Express as a ratio in the form, there are 3 blanks, the number of Free State Government learners. Okay, so if you go to the Free State, They want to know the government learners. So you would see that it's the 14 over here. It's in thousands. So therefore, it's the 14,000. Two, the second one that they are asking, to the private learner transport. Now, private learner transport is the 88. Remember to put the thousands. And then the last one that you had to fill in total. So then it's 102,000. So it's 14,000 to 88,000 to 102,000. That is the answer for 3.1.2. Let's move on to, which is your 4.2. Let's move on to your 4.3. Write down the number of Northwest learners who used private learner transport in 2022 as a percentage of total learners of RSA. Okay, so you had to go to the Northwest. Let's just see. Northwest is over here. The private learners here is 204,000. Please remember to put your thousands over the total number of people. Now, the total number of people was this number at the bottom here. 3,472,000 times with 100. Okay, I think I'm going to put the answers up on the screen again. I think it's a little bit difficult for you.
Okay.
Okay, so I just want to show you by 3.1.2, the 14,000 to the 88,000 to the 102,000, the RT, you get one RT, that means reading from a table, and then that you have put it in the correct order, like it's been asked. Right, for 4.3, this is what I was talking about, the number of learners from the Northwest that use private transport in 2022, over the total number of learners, it's a probability times with 100 gives you the 5.87. Learners, please note, it says here's no penalty for rounding because they didn't stay to two decimal places. If you have rounded it correctly to two decimal places, in other words, 5.88, you will get your 2 marks, or to 5.9, even 6%. Okay, that will give you the correct answer. So this is then the end of our session. Thank you so much, learners. I hope that you have learned something today.